Welcome to the second session of Bhagavad Gita class. Last week we saw Arjuna put his foot as well as his Gandiva down and say that he is in no mood to fight. We saw the grief and confusion of Arjuna. Today, let us see how Krishna responds in this chapter called Sankhya Yoga. Before the study begins, there will be a small quiz program which will be conducted by Dr. Ahalya.
Namaste. Harihi Om. Friends, we learned the first chapter last week. Let's look at some salient features of the chapter now. What is the significance of the first chapter, Arjuna Vishada Yoga? This chapter serves as an introduction to this epic and establishes the context and foundation on which this Gita dialogue takes place. It also introduces the Guru and Shishya. This chapter presents the basic human problem of samsara, and the student Arjuna symbolizes a common man. Then the question comes, what is samsara? Vyasacharya presents the context in which Arjuna discovers that he has certain problems, issues with his emotions, which we refer to as samsara. Samsara, as Swami Paramarthanandaji explains, is a combination of raga, attachment, shoka, grief, and moha, delusion. These emotions are universal, irrespective of country, age, religion, gender, and hence we call it the basic human problem. Then what is raga? Raga is emotional or psychological dependence on external factors. It is attachment to people or objects. That means my happiness is hooked to another external factor. So when the object of attachment is according to my liking, I am happy. When that changes, I am unhappy. Raga is attachment. Does that mean we don't get attached to our near and dear ones? Let's understand the difference between raga, attachment, and prema, love. Attachment is unconditional, comes from weakness, focuses on receiving, is selfish, and may lead to violation of dharma. Love, on the other hand, is unconditional, comes from strength, focuses on giving and doing things for others, and never leads to violation of dharma. What is shoka then? It is grief or depression due to the loss of the object of attachment. A strange thing is that it need not be an actual happening. This loss could just be a fear, an imagination, a thought alone, but can lead to grief. What is moha? Confusion, delusion, indecision is called moha. Clouded intellect that compels one to make wrong decisions or consider right as wrong and wrong as right. This inversion is called moha. So never take a decision when in confusion. What is Arishadvarga? Ari is enemy and shad is six. So the six internal enemies are called Arishadvarga. They are referred to as malam or impurity, kama desire, krodha anger, lobha greed, moha delusion, mada arrogance, and matsarya jealousy. Now, these six have to be won over. What prevents us from understanding our true nature? A common question that we would have. Shastram talks of three reasons. Malam, impurity of mind, vikshepa, extrovertedness, all sense organs are outward facing, avaranam, ignorance. The remedy is malam through karma yoga, that is proper action plus proper attitude, leading to chitta shuddhi, a clear mind. Vikshepa, that has to be won over with upasana yoga, various techniques of meditation and mantra japa, as we will see in the future classes. Avaranam is removed by jnanam, self-analysis. Why is Gita called Moksha Shastra? Bhagavad Gita is the essence of Upanishads, which is the essence of Vedas. This is Smriti Pramana, where the teachings are presented in poetic form. The teachings of Gita lead one to acquire emotional strength and also attain freedom from internal disturbances, irrespective of external circumstances, either favorable or unfavorable. Our Guru says, freedom from mental diseases caused by external factors is moksha. Our aim is to learn such a moksha shastra for a peaceful, secure, happy life. I now request Sri Vishwanath ji to please introduce Dr. Timmappa Hegde. Namaste.
Thank you, Dr. Ahalya. Good evening to all of you all. It is my pleasure and honor to introduce our teacher and principal facilitator for the series of 20 classes of Bhagavad Gita that you all have signed up to. Dr. Timmappa Hegde is currently the director and senior consultant neurosurgeon at Narayana Institute of Neurosciences, Bangalore. He was earlier the professor of neurosurgery at NIMHANS, Bangalore. He is the past president of Neurospinal Surgeons Association of India. Dr. Hegde has authored 40 scientific publications in leading journals and has edited a book on the history of neurosciences. Coming to his work specifically in Vedanta, Dr. Hegde has widely spoken in national and international forums on Vedantic scriptures such as Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads, and evangelizes various other religious scriptures. Dr. Hegde approaches towards spiritual teaching is holistic, alluding, and showing the interrelationship of several religious texts from Buddhism, Sufism, Upanishads, etc. He has delivered more than 250 talks on various topics related to Vedanta, and you can access them on YouTube. He has also delivered TEDx talk, which connects neurosciences to spiritual wisdom. You can again see them in YouTube. Dr. Hegde has created a unique model of teaching Vedantic scriptures, where he mentors budding Vedanta students eventually to become teachers. You will get to hear from few such students today who have become teachers of Vedanta through his guidance. Dr. Hegde frequently visits premier B schools such as Indian Institute of Management in India, and he is a sought-after speaker to address school teachers and head of the institutions across India. He is a person with interest in many walks of life and lives what he is teaching. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Hegde. Sir, please guide us through the class. Hari Om.
Tvameva mata cha pita tvameva, tvameva bandhuscha sakha tvameva, tvameva vidya dravinam tvameva, tvameva sarvam mama deva deva. We have a privilege of studying the Bhagavad Gita. Today is our second class, and the second chapter being a longer chapter, we decided to cover it in two parts. And in today's class, we will be covering from verses 1 to 37. We've had a recap of the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, and you see the situation now that Arjuna is in, and we need to see ourselves as Arjuna embedded with the problem of samsara. And here comes the teacher, the hero comes in today to solve the problem of samsara by giving us moksha by means of self-knowledge. Krishna has two main objectives. The first and immediate objective is to help Arjuna to fight the war. The second objective is more fundamental, and that affects all of us, is the problem of samsara. The solution to this problem is understanding who we really are, which is called self-knowledge, because normally we identify ourselves with the incidental me, which is not the real me. Krishna has three kinds of approach. First is philosophical, second is ethical, and third is practical or worldly approach. All of us now have come here for self-knowledge. There are four approaches to self-knowledge. First is to discover that the problem is with me. a spiritual student from now on is very clear that I will stop blaming anybody else for my problems. This is the first and important step to understand that the problem is in me. I'm not going to change people around me. I'm not trying to change the situation around me, because primarily the problem now I know is with me. Second is the understanding of a certain amount of helplessness. I have done all that I know that is possible, and I find that all that I know is not a solution. And when I know that that is not a solution, I surrender to a higher source of knowledge, like a guru or an acharya, and this requires a lot of humility. The fourth is, once I come to a teacher, now I make a commitment. It is not one class, but it is a series of classes that will help me to understand what this self-knowledge is all about. There is an Upanishad called the Mundaka Upanishad, which has a very relevant mantra which goes like this: Pariksha Lokan Karmachitan Brahmana. Brahmana here means a wise person who has examined his life, who has seen what is that I have accomplished with all the hard work that I have done all these years. And when you see that, you come to a state of Nirvedyam. A Nirvedyam means Vairagya, but in local language, it's a situation like what Arjuna has come, a kind of helplessness, a kind of frustration, a certain amount of realization. Although I have accomplished so much, compared to others, I stand nowhere. And then I realize something very important, and the words go, Na asti akrit kritena. Kritena means, through finite efforts, I can never attain the infinite. And what is all our craving? I want to become so big as possible. And to attain that, tat vijnartham sa gurum eva abhigacchet. Now, once I know that this is my goal, that I want purnatvam, I want the infinite, I come to those people who have attained the infinite. Samitpani Shotriya Brahmanishta. Brahmanishta is one who is anchored in the Brahman. Shotriya is one who can communicate. And that is the shift that we are looking at. This chapter that we are going to study has got four parts. In today's class, we will be dealing with the first two parts. The first part is called the Karpanya Avastha, or the Sharanagati of Arjuna, where the seeker has now realized his utter helplessness, that through normal efforts, I am not able to attain to a sense of fulfillment. And the second part is called Jnana Yoga. Jnana means wisdom. What wisdom are we looking for? We haven't had enough of worldly wisdom. Whenever we say Jnana Yoga, we mean Atma Jnana Yoga. Atma means the knowledge of my real self. In the next week, we'll be studying about Karma Yoga and Jivan Mukti, which are the two very important aspects of this beautiful chapter, the second chapter. To explain the first part of this chapter, where Arjuna is going through extreme samsara and how he surrenders to the teacher, I will request Dr. Sundar, plastic surgeon at St. John's Medical College, to please take over and explain the scenario, what we had from the first chapter to the transition in Arjuna.
Hari Om, Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Good evening to everybody watching this program. So we saw at the end of the first chapter, Dhanurdhara Partha is down on his knees, unable to perform his Swadharma because he is suffering from the universal problem of samsara, which, as we saw the last time, being a syndrome, a combination of raga, shoka, and moha. Now we start the second chapter, Sankhya Yoga. It starts with the opening comments from Sanjaya. So Sanjaya narrates Arjuna, who is sorrowful, whose vision is blurred because his eyes are filled with brimful of tears. He has become a mere caricature of the reputation that he carries. We would expect at this point that Krishna would render a soothing shoulder to his dear friend Arjuna. However, we'll see in the next two verses that Krishna is severely reprimanding and rebuking Arjuna. As we see in this verse, कूटस्त्वा कश्मलमिदं विषमे समुपस्थितं अनार्यजुष्टमस्वर्घ्यं अकीर्तिकरम अर्जुन. सो कृष्णा टेल्स अर्जुन विषमे समुपस्थितं एट दिस रॉन्ग प्लेस एट दिस रॉन्ग टाइम हाउ हैव यू गॉट कश्मलम विच इज अ मेंटल इंप्यूरिटी ऑफ डिजेक्शन डिप्रेशन फ्रस्ट्रेशन. He further rebukes by using adjectives like anarya justam. This mental behavior doesn't befit an Aryan. According to Swami Paramatmananda, it says that it is adharmic. Aswargyam, this will not lead you to heaven. Akirtikaram, while you are here, it will cause ill fame to you. We see in the third verse, Krishna continues with this rebuke. He is using strong words like, as we see in the next slide, klaibhyam shudram hrudaya dorbalyam. Krishna is telling Arjuna, why this unmanliness, why the weak mindedness, why are you being chicken hearted, why are you being faint hearted? After whipping Arjuna thus, as it were, he asks Arjuna, tvekta uttishta parantapa. Parantapa, you have got the reputation of being a scorcher of your foes. Get up and fight. One would wonder, Krishna, who is later going to be a Jagadguru, who is a Brahma Vidya Jnani, who has got with him the permanent treatment for this problem of samsara, why he is not offering this treatment to his dear friend Arjuna? As we see, Acharyas have analyzed this and they say that there are two reasons why Krishna does not begin Gitopadesha as yet in chapter 2.2. One reason is we have seen towards the end of the first chapter, Arjuna gives a sermon as it were to Krishna, telling him what are the ills if a family falls down, what is the ills if a society falls down. He has several preconceived notions. There is no sign of surrender in Arjuna. And in such a situation, spiritual wisdom cannot come about. The second reason Acharya say is Arjuna is in emotional turmoil. And in this situation, spiritual wisdom cannot arise. Krishna is cleverly whipping up the emotions to exhaust Arjuna emotionally so that he becomes helpless and he asks and he surrenders and asks Krishna to help him out. And that is what happens in the next few verses as we see. So these are the beginning verses for Arjuna in this chapter. And as he opens his mouth, it is very evident that he is severely suffering samsara. In 4, he says, how can I attack Bhishma and Drona, who are my gurus with arrows? They are worthy of worship. All the durbuddhe approach that he had in the previous chapter has now vanished. He is looking at adharmic people as those who are worthy of worship. This problem gets exaggerated in the 5th verse, where he is stating, if I kill them, I will enjoy only blood-stained pleasures. Enjoying pleasures was never a consideration. He is a Kshatriya warrior. He has to right a wrong. He has to establish dharma. And that has gone from the back of his mind. He further goes to say, I would rather beg and live rather than kill my noble gurus. For Kshatriya warriors, whose main swadharma is to wage a dharma yuddham, he is now talking about yuddha palayanam. He is talking about an escapist sannyasa. So far we see Arjuna has gone through samsara. He independently tries to solve this problem and takes a wrong decision of yuddha palayanam, which is called as viparyaya. So he has gone from samsara to viparyaya. Yet the problem for Arjuna is, if he does not do his swadharma, he who has been trained in dharma shastra knows that he will suffer a sin of omission, which is called pratyavaya papam. And if he wages the war and kills his gurus, he'll again suffer the papam of guru vadha. So from viparyaya, he's slowly moving to the next stage, which is samshaya, which becomes concrete in the next verse, as we see. In this verse number 5, verse number 6, we see that he has confusion. He is telling, it is not clear whether we should conquer them or they should conquer us. So this is the third stage from samshaya to viparyaya, sorry, from samsara to viparyaya to samshaya. Now, for a student who is looking for spiritual wisdom, this is a big transition from viparyaya, where there is wrong decision, to samshaya, where I am now doubting my decision and I am now open for spiritual wisdom. Now we come to the most important verse in this section, the seventh verse. Karpanya dosho upahata svabhavah prachamitvam dharma sammudachetah yashreyasyan nischitam bruhitan me shishyasteham sadimam tvam prapannam. So in the first line, Arjuna's state of mind is indicated. Svabhavah refers to the mind. This mind is upahata, overwhelmed by karpanya dosha, which is the defect of helplessness. Chetaha refers to the intellect, and that intellect has become dharma sammuda. So Arjuna is clearly telling, I am having delusion. I am not able to differentiate between dharma and adharma. With this state of mind, he is asking Krishna, prachamitvam. He is asking Krishna, yad shreya, what is shrestha, what is the best for me? Syan nischitam bruhi, tell me definitively that. And then he goes on to say, shishyasteham, I am your student. Sadimam, teach me. Tvam prapannam, I am surrendering to you. An interesting thing in the second line is, in the first part, he is telling, yat shreya nischitam bruhi tanme. So he seems to be asking for a piece of advice, a kind of preaching, which will solve his immediate problem. However, if we focus on the second part of that line, I am your student, teach me. Now, one important thing our acharyas tell is, spiritual wisdom is always passed on in the sampradaya as a teaching and not as a preaching. The difference between the two is, in the case of a preaching, it is like the temporary problem is solved. But when I reach to the next problem, I again have to go to somebody to get my problem solved. Whereas when it is said, shishyasteham sadimam, it means I am going through the sampradayic teaching. There is shravana manana happening. There is consistent and systematic study of scriptures under an acharya for a length of time. One may wonder, is the battlefield a situation for such learning? The battlefield is very appropriate for us grihasthas, for whom everyday professional and family life is resolving conflict. The message here is, there is no quick shortcut solution. One has to go through a systematic and consistent study of scriptures to solve this problem of samsara once and forever. The next slide beautifully depicts the stages in which Arjuna has gone. So we saw from samsara, he went to viparyaya, where he tried independently to solve. Then he went to samshaya, and then he was clear, I am unable to solve myself. So there is karpanyam, helplessness, and then sharanagati to a guru, for fortunately for him, who was available right in front. So now the stage is prepared. Arjuna, whose mind is now free from all preconceived notions, emotional upheaval, is a qualified student. And in front of him, there is more than able guru in Krishna. And the qualification of guru is hinted in a very subtle manner in this verse number 10, where we see the expression. Next slide, we have seen the stages. Next slide, sir. So we see the expression here, Hrishikeshaha Prasanna Iva. So we can see in this diagram, there is a smiling Krishna just before the Gita Upadesha begins. He is not smiling at the pitiable condition of Arjuna. It is a smile, a clear indication that the guru is free from the problem of samsara. It indicates asangatvam. It indicates sakshi bhava. He is as free from samsara as we are as free from the dream that we may have had the previous night. So with this interesting turn of events, the stage is now set for Gita Upadesha to begin. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sundar, for a very clear presentation of the transition of Arjuna from Dhanurdhara Partha to how he has become a student now ready to study, who has identified his problem. And only when the student is very receptive when the student is able to know the problem is with me, that is when the teacher is able to take over and the teaching starts. The real Bhagavad Gita starts from the 11th verse of the second chapter, and Adi Shankara's commentary begins from here. In our scriptures, there is a certain style in presenting. And this is called, just like in our news, we have the headlines before and the headlines once again. The headlines are called Sankshepa. Sankshepa is the main points which are given and which is elaborated in the course of the presentation, which is called Vistarana. When the headlines are given in the beginning, in Sanskrit, it is called Upakrama. And when the same headlines are given at the end, it's called Upasamhara. So that is how the second chapter is a summary of the entire Bhagavad Gita. The 18th chapter is a Upasamhara Sankshepa. So in between these two chapters is the entire teaching of the Bhagavad Gita. There is another beautiful style in the teaching of our scriptures. There is a famous Upanishad called Isha Vasya Upanishad, which begins with Om Purnamada Purnamidam. In the first word itself, the entire teaching is given. So you have to be very sensitive to the teaching in the 11th verse. The 11th verse of the second chapter and the 66th verse of the 18th chapter are two wonderful verses where some of our teachers like Swami Paramarthananda, Swami Dayananda has spent hours on this particular verse, both the 11th verse and the 18th verse. In one verse, the entire wisdom has been given, and that is how this particular verse is going to be elaborated. And just before this particular verse on which so much commentary has been given, let us do a short open eye meditation as you look at the face of Shri Krishna. From now on, it is not an ordinary text. From now on, it is a scriptural discussion. Whenever we listen to a scripture, we listen to it with a lot of reverence. And that word in Sanskrit is called Shraddha. Shraddha means, just like we say, it is gospel truth. It is what God has spelled out for us. Scriptures are also called a testament. A testament is one in which the truth is testified. Somebody verifies. Like when you go to a court, you say, I testify, I verify. That means somebody, there is a nice word called Sakshi. In Sakshi is the witness. So here is a person who is giving you the truth. For a moment, just look into the eyes of Lord Krishna. And as you watch the eyes, close your eyes for a moment. Internalize that smiling picture of the Lord. And be receptive for scriptural wisdom, which can transform the way you think, the way you live. There is no greater stress buster than understanding who we are through the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita, which is given in the opening verse by Lord Krishna. You may gently open your eyes. From now on, let us be receptive to the words of Sri Bhagavan Vacha, because now we are listening to a Jagat Guru. This is the essence of the entire Gita. While talking in the first chapter, I had told you the story of the Golden Buddha. The Golden Buddha story only tells us that we are not normal, not ordinary human beings. Body mind looks ordinary, but within that body mind of ours, there is that Golden Buddha waiting to be expressed. And as long as I do not know who I really am, the problems of the world become very real. So that is why self-ignorance is the cause of all problems. Self-knowledge is the only solution. Told in Sanskrit, Atma Agnanam Samsara Karanam, Atma Jnanam Moksha Karanam. To explain this verse about why wise people do not grieve, I will request Chetana to explain. Chetana, please.
Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha.
Picture the scene now. A sorrowful Arjuna surrendering to Sri Krishna for a solution to his problems. Now there is a shift in the dynamics of their relationship. Krishna, the friend and charioteer, Parthasarathi, becomes the teacher, Gitacharya or Jagat Guru, and Arjuna becomes the student. Krishna had kept quiet till now because Arjuna was not ready to listen. He was caught up in his own delusion and trying to solve it himself. It's like some people make a self-diagnosis of their health issues and try to self-medicate with disastrous results. Only then they approach a doctor and are ready to be treated. In the same way, Krishna allows Arjuna to vent out all his sorrow, and then finally, helpless, he looks towards Krishna for answers. Once Arjuna is ready to listen, then only Krishna takes over, and immediately he shifts into top gear. Remember, this is happening in the middle of the battlefield, and he wants Arjuna to pick up his bow and fight as soon as possible. So he takes a three-step remedy for Arjuna's problems. He begins with the philosophical approach, Adhyatmika. Then he comes down a little lower and says, takes up an ethical or dharmic approach. And finally, he takes a worldly or laukika approach. So this verse is a philosophical approach, the 11th verse where the real teaching begins. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha, Asochyan Anvasochas, Tvam Pragnya Vadam Shabhashase, Gatasu Nagatasumsha Na Anusochanti Panditaha. This is the central message of Gita, and the rest of the Gita from this verse up to the 66th verse in the 18th chapter is an elaboration of this verse. That is why Adi Shankara begins his commentary from this seed verse. The entire Gita Shastra is condensed here. So what is the essence that Krishna wants to convey here? He's saying that self-ignorance is the cause of all human problems, and that self-knowledge is the only way out of it. Atma Ajnanam Samsara Karanam, Atma Ajnanam Moksha Karanam. We heard before. Moksha gives us freedom from this samsara. So how does Krishna convey this idea here in this verse? See, in the second line, he says, Na Anusochanti Panditaha, means wise people, the Panditas, do not grieve. And who are these wise people referred to here? They are the people with self-knowledge. It means those who, so here it just means that those who grieve are ignorant about their real self. So Krishna's message here is also a message to all of us. It is relevant even now. He repeatedly says, do not grieve, Arjuna, do not grieve. Also in the subsequent verses, verse 25 to 27. So chitum na arhasi. Why is he emphasizing this? He wants us to know that grief is because of attachment. And Arjuna, including us, mistake that to be love. And that was beautifully brought out by Dr. Sundar and Ahalya. They are not the same thing. Attachment leads to bondage and more psychological dependence, whereas love signifies freedom and selflessness. Gita is against attachment, but not love. So what is the solution for this samsara problem, for this ignorance? It is self-knowledge. That is the only remedy. It's like if the room is dark, the only solution is to bring in light. In the same way, nothing else can remove self-ignorance except jnanam or self-knowledge. That is why Krishna is emphasizing, become wise and you will not grieve. Grief regarding what? Gatasun agatasuncha. Wise people do not grieve for the living ones, nor do they grieve for the dead ones. That is the only thing that we grieve about. They do not grieve that which is past. They do not grieve that which is present or future. He further says, Asochyan Anvasochya. Arjuna, you're grieving for those who do not deserve any grief, because all those on the Kaurava side, even if they are your relatives and friends, are adharmic. So don't speak like a wise person when you are not one. Pragnya Vadam Shabhasase. So what is Krishna's message to all of us through Arjuna? If we are grieving for the loss or the very thought of loss of someone or something, then we have not understood the message given in the Gita. Like an actor who dons several roles and plays all of them to the best of his abilities. But at the end of the drama, he does not identify with any of them. He is not the role he played. So play the role that life has given to the best of your ability as a son, daughter, father, boss, employee, etc. But some will argue that my suffering is real. But we have to ask ourselves the question, who is suffering? If you go to see, it is the mother, the father, the son, daughter role that is suffering, not the real I. So Krishna's message from this verse up to verse 30 is to tell us that the real I is not the person who I think I am. And I have to make an inquiry into who am I to get out of this samsara problem. So the rest of the Gita from here on gives us the answer to who am I. Thank you.
Thank you, Chetana, for a very nice explanation of the key verse. Although it has been explained very clearly, all we need to do is, it is too potent a message for us to deliver its message immediately. So we can make ourselves very receptive, keep our heart like the soil for this verse, and hope that as the teaching goes on, it will germinate, it will percolate, and we will see that I will not take my roles very seriously. I am someone other than my role. The role is something that I have been given to play as a father, as a son, as a brother. And all I need to do is, Swami Anubhavananda talks very nicely. Are you from Karnataka? Then you should Karnataka. Always identify that you are someone other than the role that you play. And when you know that, then whatever role you play, 100%. If you don't play your role 100%, then you suffer in the world. Another very big question for all of us is there, for some reason, is there some sorrow in your heart? Are you so chanti for any reason? And Krishna, again and again in this section, till verse 30, almost every verse towards the end, is reassuring Arjuna, please do not grieve, do not grieve, do not grieve. Let there be no sorrow in your heart. You have no real reason for sorrow in your heart. All the cause of sorrow is because you have taken your role very seriously. And this is the message of Sri Krishna in this very potent verse. We go to the next verse, verse 13, which goes like this. Dehi no spin yata dehe kaumaram yovanam zara tata dehantara prapti dhirastara na muhyanti. How do we understand this? Dehi nosmin yata deha. Within this body, within this deha, there is an indweller. This indweller will go through various phases. At one time, you were very little. You were a small baby. Then you have grown up into a young boy, a youth, and then middle age, and then older person. The body is constantly changing, but the indweller within the body never changes. This is a favorite example of mine. Can you look at a photograph when you are very little? Isn't that you? Your body has changed, your mind has changed, your thoughts has changed, but there is something within you that has never changed. What is not changed is the dehin, the indweller. By the body mind, that is what all our instructions is, naham deham, I am not my body. Then who am I? I am the indweller. I am that consciousness principle which never undergoes any change. This Atma, the indweller, this is what this verse says, nirvikaraha. It does not undergo any modification. This part of the Bhagavad Gita is so advanced in understanding. There are 7 points that Sri Krishna brings about. Each of these points will take a long time for a teacher to inculcate. The first point is called, I am always the subject, never an object. Whatever I experience, this whole world I experience around me, that is not me. I experience my body, I'm not my body. I experience my mind, I'm not my mind. Whatever I experience is called a prameya. It is an object of my experience. I am that which can never, is always the experiencer. And the word is aprameya. The other word says, I am Nityaha. I am there from the very beginning. If there is a beginning, I will be there till the very end if there is an end. That means I do not undergo any change. Nirvikara. It is very difficult to believe that I am Sarvagata. Sarvagata means the body is here, but the indweller, that consciousness principle, is all pervading. And another important concept is, the real me is akarta abhokta. It does not do anything. It does not therefore experience anything. And this indweller within me is the real me. In the course of this summary of this chapter, it is difficult for us to bring in all these points. And just a few weeks ago, the same group, the Param Vedanta group, if you can check on YouTube, Param Vedanta, we have done a series of talks like this on what is called the introduction to Vedanta, where some of these terms with examples have been elaborated. And if all of us are sincere students of Vedanta, I will recommend that we go through all of them so that we are able to understand these things better. There is another very beautiful verse, verse 14, which goes like this. Matra sparshasu kaunteya sita ushna sukha dukkadaya agama pahino nityaha tam titikshasva bharata. What does this word say? Matra sparsha. Sparsha means my sense organs. Matra means the sense objects. Whenever the sense organs and the sense objects meet each other, what happens? Sita ushna, cold, hot, sukha, dukkha experiences keep on coming. They come and they go, they come and they go. Because in the previous verses, Sri Krishna talked about what is permanent. Here he talks about the body, mind, and all our experiences of happiness and sorrow. They come, they go. Anxiety, tensions, worries, good days, bad days, they come and they go. The only way to handle it is tam stitikshasva bharata. You have to be mentally very strong. You have to be, you have to develop titiksha. Titiksha means mental toughness. And if you have that mental toughness, you will be able to endure your aging, your sickness, and even the death of this body and the body of all the others. These are great statements of the Bhagavad Gita. Otherwise, with the aging and sickness and death of the body, there will be sorrow. And Sri Krishna gives a very practical message of how to develop mental strength. We now come to another very important verse. Very rarely in the Bhagavad Gita, you have such strong and powerful verse as verse 16. And I will request Dr. Sachin, who is a plastic surgeon, a skilled plastic surgeon at the Narayana Hridayalaya Multispeciality Majumdar Shaw Institute. Dr. Sachin, can you explain this verse?
Hari Om, Om Guru Pyo Namaha. The verse goes like this. Nasato vidyate bhava, na bhavo vidyate sata, ubayo rapi dashtunta, vanayo stattva darshivi. In this verse, Lord Krishna explains us about the eternal nature of Atma. This is a very technical verse, one of the deepest meaning verses of the Bhagavad Gita. In this, Krishna says, Atma satya, anatma mitya. Atma has independent existence. Anatma has borrowed existence. Let us try to understand this verse and then we go to the word by word meaning. Every object has got its own intrinsic nature, its own true nature, which we call as Swarupaha. And also every object can have a certain nature borrowed from outside, and that borrowed nature we will call as incidental nature. Two words to remember here, intrinsic nature and incidental nature. In Sanskrit, Swabhavika Dharma and Agantuka Dharma. Now, Swabhavika Dharma means one's own nature. Agantuka Dharma, one that is borrowed. And whatever is intrinsic nature will be there all the time. Whereas whatever is incidental nature, that will be only temporary. So, intrinsic nature is permanent and incidental nature is temporary. Now, with this example, we can see that the vegetables are getting heated up. So that's possible because the pan is getting heated up due to the fire below. So they are borrowing the heat from the fire. So obviously, when they are taken away from the fire, this incidental borrowed property will cool down. Both the pan and the vegetable gets cooled down. But what happens to the fire itself? Even if this fire is taken to the coldest part, like Siberia, where the temperatures are well below minus 80 to 80 degrees under freezing, it will still not nasha. In the case of pan and the vegetable, it's borrowed and it's subject to nasha. Now, one more small example would make this concept more clearer for us. About the sun and the moonlight, we can see that the moon is borrowing the light from the ever effulgent and permanent source, that's the sunlight. This is evident to us every day on our earth. Every night we see the moon which borrows the light, especially on a total lunar eclipse. When the earth casts a shadow on the moon, then we realize that the moon was borrowing the light from sun. Through these examples, we should understand very clearly that incidental property is subject to arrival and departure, whereas the intrinsic or natural property is not subject to arrival and departure. But our body, what do you think? Our body, which so much pride we carry, this body-mind is a complex. Is it a permanent thing? No, it's an impermanent thing. As we all know, there is a date of birth and there is a date of death. In between these two, the body exists. And it exists because of what? The borrowed sentiency from the Chaitanya Swarupam, the Atma. So thus, we all living beings have got the borrowed existence from the ever permanent eternal Atma. So the definition of mithya would be anything that does not enjoy existence of its own, but it enjoys because of the borrowed existence. Then that which does not borrow existence is defined as satyam. This verse from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad would support our understanding about sat and asat. It goes like this: Om asatoma sadgamaya, tamasoma jyotirgamaya, mrityorma amrutam gamaya. When the one comes to understanding of Vedanta, we have two meanings of mithya. Here, it doesn't come to the general meaning of unreal to real. It means that which is seemingly existent, that is asat, to that which really is existent. This whole understanding is spiritual wisdom. And when we are able to shift the focus from which seems to exist to that which really exists, that is when you accept even the most difficult truth, that is death, and you attain the Paramatma for a state of liberation. Now look at this shloka. Asataha bhava na vidyate. Bhava means natural existence. Na vidyate is not there. Asat means from the mithya vastu, for an impermanent vastu. In this example, one can infer that every pot enjoys a borrowed existence, a temporary existence from the clay. The natural existence is not there in the pot. In that this example, what should be taken? The clay was there before the pot was made. The clay is in the pot and the clay will remain even if the pot is broken. So the pot is dependent upon the clay, not the clay dependent upon the pot. In the same way, sataha abhava na vidyate. Abhava again means non-existence or destruction. Non-existence is not there, na vidyate. Sataha means for a real thing which has natural existence. Therefore, a real thing does not have non-existence and an unreal thing does have natural existence. It has got what? Artificial existence. The unreal thing has got artificial existence. And tattva darshi bhi drishtaha. Tattva darshi means wise people. These wise people have realized clearly and grasped. Antaha means the true nature of Ubayo api anayoha, means both satyam and mithya. So through this verse, we know wise people have understood the true nature of both Atma as well as the Anatma. Lord Krishna wants us all to be wise and know the message of Brahma Satyam Jagat Mithya from this very verse. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Sachin, for a very nice explanation of this very difficult mantra which Swami Paramarthananda ji says perhaps one of the deepest mantras in the whole of the Upanishad. Essentially, this mantra says that is the same as the mantra, Asato Ma Sadgamaya. There are so many things in this world which appear to be real, but our scripture says they are not as real as you think they are. The real one is the seer and not the objects that you see. And this is possible through the light of knowledge. And if this is understood, we move from the fear of death, or we move experience a state of deathlessness. It may look like this is a prerogative of very few. We are all ordinary people. Gautama Buddha had made one statement. If even one person can attain to this, it is our potential to attain. And let us all say, I can do it. I can understand. I can know between what is seemingly real, like a mirage water, and understand that from that, I can shift to what is real. We have another very deep and a very popular verse. Dr. Komal Prasad, Senior Consultant Neurosurgeon at the Narayana Institute of Neurosciences. Could you explain this verse for us, Dr. Komal?
Thank you, sir. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Verse 20. Na jayate mriyate va kadachit na bhuyam nayam bhutva bhavita va na bhuyaha ajo nitya shashvatoyam purano na hanyate hanyamane sharire. This is another highly philosophical verse, and it is derived from Upanishads, the Kathopanishad. To highlight its importance, the verse is a little longer. The essence of this verse is that the Atma is free from all modifications or changes. Nirvikara Atma. Vikara means change. Nir means free from. Nirvikara means free from change. All the objects we experience in the world around us will undergo change over time. In living beings, the change is obvious and is classified into six types or stages. Asti, existence in seed form. Jayate, it takes birth. Vardhate, it grows. Viparinamate, changes or metamorphosizes. Apakshiyate, decays, becomes old over time. And finally, Vinashyati, perishes. Here, Krishna says, Atma is free from all these six modifications. It is not born, it does not grow, decay, or die. That is the essence of this verse. Na jayate means the Atma is never born. Na mriyate, Atma does not die. Kadachit, at any time. Why do you say so? That's because Na bhutva, it never came into existence in the first place. It was never born. Na abhavita, it never stops to exist in future. And therefore, it is aja, that is birthless, nitya, deathless, shashvata, free from decay, does not get old, purana, it does not grow. Na hanyate hanyamane sharire, Atma does not get afflicted by any disease. It does not go out of shape, and therefore Atma is free from viparinama also, that's free from change. Therefore, Atma is called Nirvikara. To summarize, the Atma does not undergo any of the six modifications we generally see in all the objects we experience around us. Here, Lord Krishna is talking about the nature of self, that's the Atma Swarupam, and how it is different from anatma, the body-mind complex. To understand the nature of Atma, Atma Swarupam, is the crux of the problem what we are into now. So to give an example, suppose I give you a quiz question or a riddle. I will give you some attributes of a simple food item we consume daily. You'll have to think about it and tell me what it is. It's not a vegetable, not a fruit or a grain. It does not grow in a plant or a tree. It does not perish easily. It is an essential component of most of our food. It pervades and gives taste to most of our food items. So if I tell you this, after some thinking, you can tell me the correct answer as salt, common salt. It pervades most of our food items. Similarly, Krishna is trying to impart the knowledge of Atma. Sri Krishna is imparting the knowledge of Atma through the attributes of Atma. It's very difficult, however, because by definition, Atma does not have any attributes. So what does he do? He first points out that Atma is Nitya, means Atma is eternal. It is like an equation, mathematical equation, in which we'll have to find X. So when I gave you some attributes of common salt, and you could think about it and deduce that X is common salt. Here again, find X, and this X here is Atma, or Chetana, consciousness. That's what we are trying to find. The attributes, seeming attributes of that, first Krishna pointed out that Atma is Satya, meaning it is eternal. Even when the body is born and gone, Atma continues to exist. Next, he pointed out that Atma is Satya. Atma is the reality. It exists independently. Everything else depends upon Atma for existence. Then he pointed out that Atma is Sarvagata. That means Atma is all-pervading, like space. Even though the bodies are many, the Atma which is behind every body is that all-pervading Atma. Next, he points out that Atma is Aprameya. It is never an object of experience. It's the experiencer of everything. As in any photograph, we can see anything in a photograph. We can click any picture from a camera. But one thing we cannot see, we can never see, is the camera or the photographer. You know there is a camera, you know there must be a photographer, but it never comes in the picture. How many pictures ever you take, camera can't be seen in any of the photographs. Similarly, the whole world is a picture in front of you. You can experience everything except one thing, that is yourself. Therefore, Atma is ever experiencer, never the experienced. In Sanskrit, it's called Aprameya. Then Krishna says, Atma is Akarta and Abhokta. It is neither a doer of any action, nor it reaps the benefit or result of any action. It is beyond pleasure and pain. And finally, Krishna points out in this verse that Atma is Nirvikara, free from all the six modifications like birth, growth, change, decay, and death. Therefore, there's no question of birth, growth, decay, or death for Atma. Now, having separated the body and consciousness, the Atma, the next aim is to question which one of these two I am. This important aspect will be discussed in the next verses. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Komal. Again, as I said, these will take some time for us to understand about the real nature of the Atma, which is my real nature. I am the reality. I am there for all time. Difficult to believe, but the real me or consciousness is not limited to this body, but it is everywhere. It cannot be an object of my experience, and the real me does not undergo any modifications. Najayate Mriyateva. There are very similar verses, and I will quickly rush through this most interesting part of the Bhagavad Gita, which another verse which goes like this. Vasamsi jirnani yata vihaya navani ghritnati naroparani. I remember once when Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was dying, and his wife Sharada breaks down to tears. He looks at her with all the confidence of a master, and he says, you know, what is happening is about my body. He says, I am not going to die. My body is like my clothes, just like my clothes, exactly the same particular verse. And Sharada Devi understood his message and was able to understand the immortality of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, as elaborated in this particular verse. There is another beautiful verse which goes, Nainam Chindanti Shastrani, Nainam Dahati Pavakaha. None of these four elements, the earth, the water, the fire, and the wind, none of them can kill me. It seems when the Indian freedom fighters were going to the gallows, all of them were chanting with gusto, Nainam Chindanti Shastrani, Nainam Dahati Pavaka. And the British made an arrest warrant to find out who is the author of that person who said this, which was motivating all these people. So this is the essence, if you understand that the real me has no deathless at all. Now, after spending enough on the philosophical aspect, because giving all the message, Lord Krishna comes to verses which talk about dharma and tells Arjuna, see, you are a Kshatriya and it's a Kshatriya dharma to fight. And even if he does not understand that from a worldly level, what will other people say? Don't you feel ashamed about the criticisms of other people? So these are the words which talk about the dharma. This is a righteous war. And as a Kshatriya, it is your Swadharma to fight. What will other people say? They will write about you and forever you will be known as a person who ran away from the battlefield. And that is how up to verse 36 to 37 is the course of this particular chapter. As we are running through a very, very important chapter, if these topics are going to become easily understandable, I want you to be prepared for the next class. And in the next class, we start from around this time. There is one beautiful verse which I have little time to explain. Traigunya Vishaya Veda Nistraigunyo Bhava Arjuna. The three gunas, sattva, rajas, and tamas, affect us. But Krishna says, go beyond the karma. Nistraigunyo Bhava Arjuna Nirdvando. Don't be caught by these opposite. Don't worry about yoga and kshema. Nitya sattvastva, if you are anchored into sattvastva, atmavan, and if you are a student of atmavidya and if you acquire this knowledge, I will take care of you. The beautiful karma yoga will come again in the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Although the third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita is primarily dedicated to understanding how to transform word to worship. Some of the most popular verses like Karmanyave Adhikaraste Ma Paleshu Kadachana. These popular verses are there, which will be there in the next class. And there is another beautiful verse which says, Buddhi Yukto Jahatita Ube Sukrute Dushkrute Tasmad Yogaya Yujasya Yogaha Karmasu Kausalam. Whenever you become an expert in doing any action, whenever you become skilled in action, you attain to an ability where you work as if you are not working. These are very, very profound verses in Karma Yoga, which you will study in the next class. Then comes the Stita Prajna part, where Arjuna has a curiosity to know, you know, once a person gets Brahma Vidya, once a person knows his true nature, if a person is anchored in wisdom, what is called a Stita Prajna, how does such a person speak? How does he sit? How does he walk? All this we will be listening in the next class, where Krishna, for this, gives a super brilliant answer. He says, Prajahati yada kaman sarvan partha manogata atman evatmana tushtaha. One who has understood himself, one who realizes that I am complete just by myself. I don't need any object, any person, any situation. I have no desires to be fulfilled. Such a person is a sita prajna, and very beautifully elaborated in. There is one googly verse which needs a lot of elaboration. Adi Shankara has given an elaborate commentary on this particular verse, which says, Ya Nisha Sarva Bhutani Tasyam Jagrati Samyami. That means, for what is day for an ordinary person is night for a jnani, and what is night for an ordinary person is day for a jnani. That means, for all of us, this world is real, and Brahman, we do not know what Brahman or Atman is. But for a jnani, that means one who has spiritual wisdom, this world is mithya. This world is not as real. Just like I see the sun setting or the sun rising, but I know the sun does not set or the sun does not rise. My experiences are not real. The experiencer in me is real. Very profound words to be prepared for. And finally, there is the beautiful conclusion of the chapter in the 72nd verse, which says, Yesha Brahmi Stiti Partha Nainam Prapya Vimuhyati. Once you attain to this understanding of Brahma Vidya, it is like learning how to cycle or learning how to swim. There is no falling back from this situation. I'll request your patience for a few minutes to listen to the chanting of the Bhagavad Gita. Just be patient. Bhagavad Gita is a Gita. It has to be chanted. I will request Shyamala and Meenakshi to chant these verses for us. be maybe 5 or 6 minutes. I request your attention, please.
Hari Om, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. Ashochyananvashochastvam. Prajnyavadamscha bhashase.
Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. Ashochyananvashochastvam. Prajnyavadamscha bhashase.
Gatasunagatasumscha. Nanushochanti panditaha.
Gatasunagatasumscha. Nanushochanti panditaha.
Natve vaham jatunasam. Natvam neme janadina.
Natve vaham jatunasam. Natvam neme janadhipaha.
Na chaiva na bhavishyamaha. Sarve vayamatah param.
Na chaiva na bhavishyamaha. Sarve vayamatah param.
Dehi nosmin yatha dehe. Kaumaram yavanam jara.
Dehi nosmin yatha dehe. Kaumaram yauvanam jara.
Tata dehantara praptihi. Dhirastatra namuhyati.
Tata dehantara praptihi. Dhirastatra namuhyati.
Matra sparshastu kaunteya. Shitoshna sukha dukkhadaha.
Matra sparshastu kaunteya. Shitoshna sukha dukkhadaha.
Agama payino nityaha. Tamstitikshasva bharata.
Agama payino nityaha. Tamstitikshasva bharata.
Yam hi na vyathayantyete. Purusham purusharshabha.
Yam hi na vyathayantyete. Purusham purusharshabha.
Samadukha sukham dhiram. Somrutatvaya kalpate.
Samadukha sukham dhiram. Somrutatvaya kalpate.
Nasato vidyate bhavaha. Na bhavo vidyate sataha.
Nasato vidyate bhavaha. Na bhavo vidyate sataha.
Ubhayorapi drushtontaha. Tvanayostatva darshibhihi.
Ubhayorapi drushtontaha. Tvanayostatva darshibhihi.
Avinashitu tadvidhi. Yena sarvamidam tatam.
Avinashitu tadvidhi. Yena sarvamidam tatam.
Vinashamavyayasyasya. Nakashchit kartumarhati.
Vinashamavyayasyasya. Nakashchit kartumarhati.
Antavantaime dehaha. Nityasyoktah sharirinaha.
Antavantaime dehaha. Nityasyoktah sharirinaha.
Anashino prameyasya. Tasmad yuddhasva bharata.
Anashino prameyasya. Tasmad yuddhasva bharata.
Yayenam veti hantaram. Yashchainam manyate hatam.
Yayenam veti hantaram. Yashchainam manyate hatam.
Ubhautau na vijanitaha. नायं हन्ति न हन्यते
उभौ तौ न विजानीतः नायं हन्ति न हन्यते
न जायते म्रियते वा कदाचित् नायं भूत्वा भविता वा न भूयः
न जायते म्रियते वा कदाचित् नायं भूत्वा भविता वा न भूयः
अजो नित्यः शाश्वतोऽयं पुराणः न हन्यते हन्यमाने शरीरे
अजो नित्यः शाश्वतोऽयं पुराणः न हन्यते हन्यमाने शरीरे
वेदा विनाशिनं नित्यं ययेनमजमव्ययम्
वेदा विनाशिनं नित्यं ययेनमजमव्ययम्
कथं स पुरुषः पार्थ कङ्घातयति हन्तिकम्
कथं स पुरुषः पार्थ कङ्घातयति हन्तिकम्
वासांसि जीर्णानि यथा विहाय नवानि गृह्णाति नरोपराणि
वासांसि जीर्णानि यथा विहाय नवानि गृह्णाति नरोपराणि
तथा शरीराणि विहाय जीर्णानि अन्यानि संयाति नवानि देहि
तथा शरीराणि विहाय जीर्णानि अन्यानि संयाति नवानि देहि
नैनं छिन्दन्ति शस्त्राणि नैनं दहति पावकः
नैनं छिन्दन्ति शस्त्राणि नैनं दहति पावकः
न चैनं क्लेदयन्त्यापः न शोषयति मारुतः
न चैनं क्लेदयन्त्यापः न शोषयति मारुतः
अच्छेद्योयमदाह्योऽयम् अक्लेद्यो शोषयेव च
अच्छेद्योयमदाह्योऽयम् अक्लेद्यो शोष्य एव च
नित्यः सर्वगतः स्थाणुः अचलोऽयं सनातनः
नित्यः सर्वगतस्थाणुः अचलोऽयं सनातनः
अव्यक्तोऽयमचिन्त्योऽयम् अविकार्योऽयमुच्यते
अव्यक्तोऽयमचिन्त्योऽयम् अविकार्योऽयमुच्यते
तस्मादेवं विदित्वैनं नानुशोचितुमर्हसि
तस्मादेवैनं नानुशोचितुमर्हसि
हरि ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ॐ
थैंक यू ऑल फॉर योर पेशेंट शेयरिंग वी हैव कम टू अ क्लोज ऑफ टुडेस क्लास इन आवर नेक्स्ट क्लास वी विल स्टडी द रिमेनिंग पार्ट ऑफ सांख्य योग Recording of this class is on Param Vedanta channel of YouTube. Study material will reach you. Please go through and consolidate what you have learned in the class. We shall meet next Friday, same time. Please log in before 6:45 p.m. Namaste. Now it's time to chant Shanti Mantra to end today's class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Hari Om.